we do realize, right, that we either are in nature, have to deal with nature, or supernature. There isn't any other choice other than absolute being, formless being. But Jesus says that's beyond anything we can imagine at this point. And because of our continuity issue, it's really not something we should strive to try and figure out or think about or a goal to attain. Nature or supernature is our option. So we're either going to be entertaining nature or we're going to be entertaining supernature. And the word entertaining here is very important. We are spirit. I am spirit. I am free. I am light. I am free. I am the light of the world, literally. I am actually the light that this whole world is bringing about this appearance of the world. I am the light. I am spirit. I am free. So we're the ones doing the entertaining of this appearance that appears to be crystallized. It's not. It's really just light. Light cannot crystallize, actually. So we're entertaining either nature or we're entertaining supernature. There is no other option for us, okay? This is the option we have to choose. Really, this is the option we have to choose. Either we're going to entertain nature or supernature. So keep this in mind that nature is either or. So if we don't entertain supernature, we will be entertaining nature, period. And death does not free us from that at all. Because death is just part of the cycles of nature. When you die, you're still entertaining nature. After death realm experiencing is still entertaining nature. Okay, still entertaining nature. In supernature, there aren't those cycles. There aren't those cycles. It's not cycling. There's no cycling in supernature. No dying and being reborn, dying and being reborn. There are no cycles that we call natural cycles, nature cycles. No. So we're either cycling or we get off the cycle. Okay. This is so, just consider this here as we, on this Christmas, this is Christmas Eve, but this is Christmas Day, will probably be posted late Christmas Eve. This is it. So either we are entertaining nature or entertaining supernature. And then the more this can dawn upon us, we say, hey, wait a minute. Wait just a minute. Just let that wow sink in. Don't analyze the profundity of it. Just realize, hey, wait, wow, hey, wow. Wait a minute, sometimes it means, hey, whoa, wow. It's like, hey, I'm feeling this wow, just a minute. And let me, this is a real big wow. I'm entertaining, either going to be entertaining nature or supernature. Death-free realm. This is our choice. Now, when we put it like this, it becomes very clear. So, wow. Now, let's not make a choice at this moment. Let's just feel the wow of this fact. This is the important thing, is don't stumble on yourself trying to go too fast. Is stay in the moment of your progress. Stay in the wow of your progress without having to analyze it. Just stay in it. Because this is huge. It's like, wow. Because it's like, I have a choice. I have a choice what I'm entertaining. I'm not bound by any of the cycles of nature. I'm just entertaining this dream of nature, this appearance of nature. I can entertain supernature. I can choose to entertain supernature. Of course, you can't entertain both, so to speak. Not primarily, no. So the nature is just this idea we had. Super nature is also an idea we had coming from the Holy Spirit, which is our spirit actually blessed by God, the Prime Creator. So we have this idea of super nature to solve the continuity problem. So we're either entertaining one or the other. Primarily, fundamentally. If we entertain super nature here, it will still seem to others that nature is with us. But we're in the world, but not of it, is the way that Jesus puts it. In the world, but not of it. So as always, what we do is we trigger this wow, and then we let it settle in. We get accustomed to this, familiar with this. And this is very direct, obvious, simple. Oh, I'm either entertaining nature or I'm entertaining supernature. That's my choice. It's my choice. It's like, what do you want on your plate? It's that simple, actually. There's nothing more complicated than that. What do you want on your plate? You're going to have a meal, you're going to either serve yourself a big old plate of nature, or you're going to serve yourself a wonderful plate of super nature. One of the two. You can't have a plate and pile both super nature and nature on, then mix them all together like that, no. Because if you partake of one, you won't be interested in the other. And you certainly can't mix them up. So even if you have both on your plate, you're going to either eat of one or eat of the other. So what do we want on our plate here? At Christmas is a good time to think about what you have on your plate. What do you have on your plate at Christmas? What do you want to have on your plate at Christmas is the question. Now, we may say, well, I want to have supernature on my plate, but how come I don't have it on my plate? Because we're hesitating. Why are we hesitating? Because of our familiarity with nature. We're used to nature. We're used to having nature on our plate. We think, well, supernature, that'd be something really, I don't think I'll be familiar with that. So, what we do, spiritual practice, is designed to gain familiarity with how supernature is, the isness of supernature. And the practices bring up these little wows, little wows, little wows. But you know, a river is made of many little raindrops. The water we drink is made up of little raindrops. And so to quench our thirst, our spiritual thirst, we have these little moments, many little wows that we practice. And those all add up to me feeling, hey, I feel pretty comfortable with the idea of supernature. I'm feeling like I've got sort of a comfort zone of familiarity there. It doesn't bother me. Now, it's amazing. I went through this list for the purposes of practicing the great practice that the Holy Spirit gave out. And I am spirit. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I am spirit. And trials cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Tribulations cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Breakage cannot happen to me. So I looked at all these, this list of, I wrote down all these words that say, this cannot happen to me. I am light, I am free. I am still as God created me. I am spirit, I am free. I am still as God created me. None of these things can happen to me. Actually, nothing. There isn't anything that can happen to me. There isn't anything that can happen to me whatsoever. I am the light itself. All appearances are made of light. There's nothing that can happen to light. There's nothing that can happen to spirit at all. So going over this list, it was amazing because I realized all of these descriptive terms, and there are many, 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 many. I don't know how many. But you just get the idea, you know, just page upon page upon page of descriptive terminology. They all describe nature. They all describe this world. This is what happened. As I realized, this is the experience I'm having of this world. My gosh, it's amazing to bring it into focus. Wow. I say, oh my gosh, this is what I've been experiencing all this time with nature. This is what nature gives us. Wow. Terrible. And then I realized, none of this stuff is happening in supernature. None of this stuff is happening to us in supernature. Supernature's looking better all the time, isn't it? And just seeing all of the stuff that happens, seems to be happening to us in nature. See, nature is a situation where we're believing that something can happen to us. We're trying to define what we are, and therefore we're really saying that something can happen to us. Situations, circumstances, there's something can happen to us. Saying, this is what you are, this is what you are, this is misfortune, this misfortune, this misfortune is defining you. You're being defined by misfortune, you're being defined by aggression, you're being defined by activism, you're being defined by greed, you're being defined as if absolute freedom can be defined. It cannot. So this nature is a collection of all our thoughts of trying to define what we are, trying to say that we're not what we really are, trying to say that all this stuff is happening to us. It's happening to us somehow. In other words, we're not in control, making these appearances seem like it's taking place. It's actually happening to us, even though our will says no, it's still happening to us. Okay, this is what we call nature. So these exercises, these practices, how do we get into supernature? Practice, practice, practice. Again, what's our choice? We can either, what do we have on our plate? We can either have nature on our plate, or we can have supernature on our plate. It's that simple. Now, I want to bring up something very important. What we pragmatically choose here is to battle against this sour grapes attitude, or we succumb to the sour grapes attitude. This is the big dividing line in the world. Now let's use just an example, Christianity, Christians. If you say, I am a Christian, what are you saying? You're saying, I am decided to battle against this sour grapes attitude. Essentially struggling against the continuity fear, but also battle against this sour grapes attitude. What is the sour grapes attitude? The sour grapes attitude is like this. It's saying like, well, I can't get into supernature. I'm not able to. I'm inherently incapable of getting into supernature. Therefore, I'm stuck with this world. I'm stuck with nature. In other words, I can't exchange. I'm stuck. Nature is my home. This is what I have. And therefore, we're going to just say, ah, so we don't keep hearing about it. It's terrible. I'm not interested in supernature. Supernature's crazy. It doesn't exist. There's nothing good there for me. Why even think about it? And then let's try to just make what we have, what is ours, let's make sure that we really make it nice for us, like nature, okay? So when you feel that, no, nature is it. Let's make nature as beautiful as possible. You know, it's a pipe dream to get into supernature. That's not something that's really possible for any of us, really. And certainly not me. So I'm going to mock it and decry it and say, you know, that's probably terrible anyway. You know, it's not what I really want anyway. So sour grapes to say, supernature, I don't really want that anyway. Why would anyone want that? You know, it's stupid. So it's just, who does anyone think they are thinking they can do that? That's called the sour grapes attitude. So you have two camps in the world, really. Those who believe, you know what? I can have eternal life. I can have eternal life. I can have the death-free realm. I can dwell in supernature. Yes, I can. And those who claim, no, I can't, no, I can't, no, I can't, no, I can't. Those, this is the division of the world. This is the division between the sheep and the goats, as we have been told. That in the end time, supposedly, there's going to be the sheep and the goats are going to be part ways, because the goats are saying, no way can anybody reach supernature. If I can't do it, you can't do it. See, this is part of the sour grapes attitude, is to say, well, I'm vastly wise and superior to just about everyone, and I can't do it. Therefore, who? What kind of arrogance is this to think that anyone else can do it? That's ridiculous. And we have sort of this generalized attitude in this world like that. If this group, special group, can't do it, cosmic corporate culture, others, they have these special groups that say, hey, we can't do it. And we're way superior to everyone else. And if we can't do it, nobody can. And to claim you can is absolute arrogance and is trying to, dismiss our greatness. That's a, you know, trying to say, oh, you're greater than me. You want to be greater than me? No. So this is the sour grape attitude in the world that we struggle against. That the people who want to go from whatever they want to call themselves, it essentially means you're going for eternal life. A Christian believes in eternal life, and that they can have eternal life. This is the definition of a Christian, and they're striving for that. And in many other traditions, it's quite similar. They're striving for, you know, eternal life, and they feel it's possible for them. They've been told, yes, you can. Now, in Christianity, Jesus came and tells us, yes, you can have eternal life. If you drink of the waters I'm giving you, you will have eternal life. Okay, in other words, if you do the practices, drink the waters, do the practice, eat the body and blood, do the practices, you know, the nitty gritty, actually feel it, you know, actually get in the wow of it. If you follow the wow of it, if you allow yourself to feel the wow of it, you will have eternal life, because you will. Ultimately, you will entertain supernature. You will be entertaining supernature, where it's apparent, you become aware that there's no such thing as death. It's only a mirage. Light is not crystallizing. Everything is just an appearance of light. And light is always perfect and flawless. Can never die. Nothing can happen to the light. Nothing can happen to the light. Here it appears in nature that everything has happened to the light. And that we think this is the new reality. Where there's something that's stronger, greater than the light, that is causing all this stuff to happen. It's not true. That's just a self-delusion. So, we have these two camps. We have these two camps. And so, to say I'm a Christian means I believe in eternal life, and I'm going to make the effort to get it. What's wrong with that? See, this is the question. What's wrong with that? I mean, the option is to hold on to nature. See, the option to being a Christian is to hold on to nature. Decide that you're going to grab a hold of nature, you know, and try to make it something that you feel that you will cherish forever and never let go of. See, that's the other option. So, I mean, what's wrong with being a Christian? That's the question. Christian is just someone who believes that they do deserve, that they their inheritance, eternal life is their identity, is their inheritance, is their right, is their God-given, God-created inheritance, eternal life, and they can have it, they can accept it. That's all, in fact, everyone. Eternal life is actually the case for all, for everything, for all. All is eternal life. All is just one eternal life, right now even. Always and forever. All is one eternal life, right now, always and forever. So Christians just say, hey, wait a minute, what do I want on my plate? Nature, supernature. And they say, you know what? Nature on their plate? That's okay. I mean, they should be saying that. Now, well, you know, one little mistake that Christians have made is to say, well, those who don't choose supernature are going to be destroyed, damned forever, and completely destroyed. God is good. That is not true. Okay, that is not true. You need to back off of that. Nothing's going to happen to them. They're just going to continue on with nature. Yes, somewhere. I mean, the thing is that there's likely going to be a remodeling of this planet take place. So they looked at that and they said, wow, you know, those who don't accept supernature are going to go through this, you know, tribulation and troubles here and get burned by cosmic fire. And well, all that is just talking about the cycling of nature and what happens. But they're still in the cycles of nature and they will continue. Their spirit cannot be extinguished or killed at all. So, you know, this hellfire thing, all this stuff, this is just a relative, this is a phase, okay, that will happen, a phase, it's likely to happen. It's not the end of anyone. Spirit cannot come to an end. No beginning, no ending, other than the creation by God. So, a lot of people, a lot of us, and a lot of those in the world, have taken Christianity to task, or this, and I'm judging Christianity and saying you're wrong, you're terrible. So, you know, and they've been sort of categorized, stereotyped by this. You know, I think the worst stereotyping in this world right now is taking place to Christians. Okay, well, we hear about all the progressives and how there's so much against stereotypes. I mean, in fact, you know, anything that makes them feel stereotyped, it's like the worst thing in the world. And yet they are doing this extreme, fanatical, radical stereotyping of Christians, as well as most religious people in general. As kooks, lunatics, crazies, get out of here, get out of my work, isn't it? You know, just the worst type of rabid stereotyping, and they feel totally self-righteous about it. And it's mostly around this issue of eternal damnation, okay? It's also somewhat around evolution, which bothers them, you know. but I am spirit, I am free. Evolution cannot happen to me, actually. Evolution cannot happen to me. Cannot happen to spirit. How can evolution happen to pure freedom, absolute freedom? Okay, it's part of the mirage. It's part of the mirage. It's not really. It's part of this make-believe of nature. Okay, so, but Christians are a little fuzzy about this, so they try to say, no, you know, this mirage never happened like that. Well, you know, let a mirage happen however it wants to happen. It's still a mirage, okay? There's still no such thing as evolution technically at all. It's all a creative expression of our mind, of our spirit. The light is putting on this play because we asked it to. Nothing is happening. I am spirit, I am free. Worlds cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Nature cannot happen to me. Nature cannot happen to me. I am light, I am free. Evolution cannot happen to me. See, light cannot evolve. We are the light. So for us, for the light, which is all there is, there can be no evolution. It's impossible. But, so there's some fuzziness. See, Christians have some fuzziness. Why? Because they're struggling. They're struggling with the continuity fear, but at least they're making the effort. At least they have said, "Yo, I believe in eternal life, that eternal life is an option for me." This is repentance, is to say, I believe eternal life is an option for me. Right here and now, actually. They also, a little fuzzy, saying, no, only when I die. That's trying to appease nature, right? It's saying, no, the natural cycles somehow bring me to that. No, they don't. The cycles of nature do not bring us anywhere. It just keeps cycling and cycling and cycling. Okay. Batteries dying on the cell phone. See, dead batteries again. I'm spirit, I am free. Dying cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Dying cannot happen to me. Yeah. Very important, because everything here gets feeble and wears out. You know, I am light, I am free. Wearing out cannot happen to me. See, I am light, I am free. Wearing out cannot happen to me. Wearing out cannot happen to me. So, Christians and religious people all over the world are being subjected to incredibly narrow-minded stereotypes, prejudicial, intolerant, prejudicial, narrow-minded, negative stereotyping. Extreme is the worst stereotyping I've ever come across, I believe. It's global and it's very intense. It's global and it's very intense. It's very ruthless and very merciless, you might say. And just the sheer numbers, the incredible stereotyping that's taking place. And a lot of Christians are being affected by this negative stereotyping. Okay, how can we not? I go around and everyone says, happy holidays, like they're robots. I feel very offended by that. I mean, what do you mean? It's Christmas Eve. You're gonna say happy holidays? You can't say Merry Christmas. You don't want to wish me a Merry Christmas. You don't want to wish me a blessed day, you know, on the day that's set aside to recognize the good news. All right. I mean, let's depersonalize. If you don't want to talk about a person or something, let's talk about what Christmas really stands for. It stands for the good news of eternal life. And you don't even, people, I mean, just the whole culture now, I feel, they don't even want to wish me, hey, they don't want to, they can't even say, we wish you a great day of remembrance of eternal life. Wishing you a day of remembrance of eternal life. Wishing you eternal life remembrance in this season. Wishing you eternal life remembrance in this season. Wishing you eternal life choosing in this season. No, they can't even do that. So it's a very terrible stereotyping that is taking place. And I feel it very acutely, very, very acutely. It feels super uncomfortable with this world, super uncomfortable with the stereotyping that's taking place. It's incredibly prejudicial by cherry picking out some of the confusions that Christians and religious people have as we all do, which is why there's a community of those who say, hey, we forgive your struggling, we understand that it's not easy, this continuity problem is not easy. Now, what I have found is that the problem we all make, myself included, and I see this almost without exception, we all make this same mistake because we underestimate the severity of the continuity problem. We underestimate it. So there's some who are very, very certain way, and they think they're very, very advanced in some ways, okay? But they underestimate the severity of the continuity problem. And this just traps them like in a bubble. They can't get out. They feel like they're in a bubble or something. The way out is repentance. Hey, the continuity problem is more severe than I realized. That's it. You just say, it's more severe than I realized. It's more severe than any of us realize, actually. And so it doesn't serve to take the high road. Think you take the high road and say, no, I'm on top of the situation. And, you know, that results in excessive intellectualism. You think you're on top of the situation. I'm on top of the situation. No. Never try to take that attitude until actually, you know, the full dawning. And you will know then. But until then, do not take the attitude that you're on top of the situation, because you're not. The continuity problem still pulls us back. Familiarity still pulls us back. I'm always battling it. It's scary because you realize just like that, someone can easily, socialization has it just easily pulled back into confusion. Then you just have to, don't panic, don't get upset, just say, oh, okay, it's very the continuity problem. There it is. Okay, let me turn back to my practicing and just accept, wow, this is just a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. This is what I'm experiencing. Okay, and then you stop struggling. You see, you stop when you say, oh, when you identify what the problem is, then you know, oh, okay, I know what it is. It's the continuity fear. And then you stop struggling, trying to analyze this. You say, whoa, what's happening? Just the continuity fear, I know that. Centered, immediately centered. Then you start doing some practicing. And, you know, I am not a body. Go back to start with, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. Okay, so you go back to that practicing. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. I am spirit. I am free. Distraction cannot happen to me. Distraction cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Enslavement cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Creatureness cannot happen to me. Creatureness cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Tension cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Racism cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Engrossment cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Economics cannot happen to me. Economics cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Abuse cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Radicalism cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Grief cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Brutality cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Shifting cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Hostility cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Danger cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Heartache cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Collapse cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Disruption cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Cruelty cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Incompleteness cannot happen to me. Okay? So, this is one of the very core practice ways there is that get us ready for supernature. Get us ready to put supernature on our plate. That's all we need to do. Just decide, hey, you know what? I want supernature on my plate. Now, again, the sour grape attitude is what's leading to the stereotyping of Christians, because really deep down, those who cannot turn to eternal life yet, they feel, I'm too scared. They feel very envious and frustrated of that others are doing so. Okay, and this is what leads to sour grapes, and this is what's led to this negative stereotyping of Christians and religious endeavor throughout the world. What they want to do is they want to turn all religious endeavor towards charity, doing good works for people, and abandon the goal of eternal life. This is the goal of cosmic corporate culture, which represents this massive frustration and continuity fear that seems too severe to handle. So you just say, eternal life is not an option. Therefore, I don't even have any continuity fear because I'm not ever going to go there. It's not an option for me, so I can't be suffering from that. But then they still feel like, I'm happy. It's those idiots who are believing in eternal life. No, we got to, stamp that out of their minds. Why? Because it reminds them of what they're not having and feel they can't have. And that drives them nuts, drives them crazy. And of course, I am spirit, I am free. Craziness cannot happen to me. You see, this is the remedy. It cannot happen to me because of what I am. We're just imagining that all this can happen to us. It cannot happen to us. The key to getting into supernature is to affirm that none of this stuff can happen to us. None of this, I am light, I am free, none of this stuff can happen to me. Now, there's another way to practice this. There's another way. There's a nice little variation on this. Being the spiritual musician that I seem to be, can put a little variation on this and say, I am spirit, I am free. Troubles cannot incomplete me. Okay, troubles cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Identity problems cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Barriers cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Solar systems cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Atoms cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Groups cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Discomfort cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. There isn't anything that can incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Complications cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Blackouts cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Impacts cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Partitioning cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Confusion cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Emptiness cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Addiction cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Tiredness cannot incomplete me. Tiredness cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Lostness cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Worry cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Calamity cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Insanity cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. People cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Bodies cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Gender cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Society cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Culture cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Technology cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Cosmic corporate culture cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Mechanics cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Mistakes cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Measurement cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Design cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. The flesh cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Nature cannot incomplete me. Okay, now this, some may find sometimes that they enjoy this practicing. I've done both forms, variations, and both of them are very profound. I tend to find that when you're out in the world and situations are happening, I feel like I am light, I am light, I am free. Traffic congestion cannot incomplete me. As you're struggling with traffic congestion, you know, you're thinking, wow, it feels like it's happening. So when you kind of feel like, wow, this seems like it's happening, you say, hey, this traffic congestion cannot incomplete me. Cannot make me incomplete. Cannot incomplete me. Now, for those who may be teachers of sentence structure, blah, 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 blah. Hey, I am the light. I am light. I am free. Sentence structure cannot incomplete me. I am spirit. I am free. Punctuation cannot incomplete me. I am spirit. I am free. Words cannot incomplete me. So I don't know if incomplete is a word. I guess it is, right? Incomplete me. Can't incomplete me. I've never heard that phrase before, but you're hearing it now maybe for the first time then, which is fine. It's the first time for hearing everything, right? I am spirit. I am free. Sentence structure cannot incomplete me. I am light. I am free. Complexity cannot incomplete me. Now, the sour grape stereotyping crowd who is trying to stereotype spiritual aspiration, they might say, what in the world is this for? It's ridiculous. I mean, you're just stupid, crazy. It's to get us ready for supernature. Well, they say, well, there's no such thing as supernature. So obviously, in your eyes, you're crazy. You're preparing for something that doesn't exist. This is nonsense in their eyes. This is the very danger of cosmic corporate culture, is they've used this right spiritual practice as absolute nonsense. Their aim, their goal is to get rid of it. And the aim of those who are trying to grab hold of nature and want that instead of supernature, inherently that's their purpose, is get rid of this goal of supernature, because it's bothering me. I feel conflicted. They think conflict is they think this choice, this option we have is the cause of their conflict. No, the cause of their conflict is trying to get rid of something they can't get rid of, which is truth, which is reality. That's the cause of their conflict. The remedy, the RX prescription, is right spiritual practice, full stop in the wow. Right spiritual practice, full stop in the wow. You know, so I was thinking, hey, let's start this. I am Jesus Christ. You know, I am, hey, you know that Spartacus story about some slave, and they wanted to, who's Spartacus? They wanted to capture Spartacus. You know, we don't know who he is, but he's leading this revolt against the Roman corporate empire. And they said, all right, where's Spartacus? Let's hand him over. And someone says, I am Spartacus. It might have been Spartacus who did that. I don't know. But it's a story. I am Spartacus. And everyone else is looking around saying, uh-oh. Are we going to let him, you know, take the fall for the truth that he was telling us? Hey, you can be free. You don't have to be slaves anymore. And then someone else stands forward from the line. They're all in this group. They stand forward. And says, no, I am Spartacus. So the Roman legions say, who do we kill? You know, who do we imprison? And then someone else says, no, I am Spartacus. And then someone else says, I am Spartacus. And then more, I am Spartacus. And then the whole group stands forward and says, I am Spartacus. You see, I am. Well, I say, I am Jesus Christ, you see. And then someone else says, hey, I am Jesus Christ. And then someone else, I am Jesus Christ. And then get all the Christians and all the religious, you know, say, I am Jesus Christ. You want to catch in prison Jesus Christ? Well, I am Jesus Christ. And then another one says, no, I am Jesus Christ. I am Jesus. And you have an I am Jesus Christ movement. It would be very interesting. Because the truth is, we all are one. So we all are Jesus Christ. In other words, we all are spirit. We all are free. I am light. I am free. I am spirit. I am free. Yeshua, blessed of God. We're all blessed of God. Christos, christened, anointed by what? Supernature. So he's saying, no, I'm the one who's anointed by supernature. And someone else says, I am anointed by supernature. Someone else, I am anointed by supernature. I am. And the whole group says, I am anointed by supernature. We can have it. I am Jesus Christ movement. Because it really is a saying, I am entitled to supernature. Yeah, I am entitled to supernature. And those who claim they're not, they're trying to be greater than God. So they rule out supernature as an option. They say, no. Because why? That will help us, supernature helps us realize that all our attempts to define ourselves are futile. We're not greater than God. So they don't want supernature. They say, no, because with this nature, it's easy for us to believe that we're greater than God. We can keep playing these mind games that we're playing here. But if you accept supernature, then you realize, oh my gosh, no, all is one. There's nothing greater than God. God's the originator of God. I didn't create myself. So there's still their pride in there, but really it's their continuity fear is driving them. So they want to get rid of, you know, they say, you're not entitled to supernature. Nobody's entitled to supernature. Who do you think you are entitled to supernature? You know, they hate the idea, unfortunately. So, but this is true. Jesus said, if you follow me, the world will hate you. Of course, those who follow nature hate those who are deciding for eternal life or supernature. Why? Sour grapes. Their feeling of fear. What's that fear? The continuity fear. So don't think there's some mysterious fear that's inherently causing them to fail. There's not. It's the continuity fear. And the continuity fear absolutely can and will be evaporated as soon as you start working on it. So nobody's going to be left behind. Nobody is inherently incapable of eternal life. It's absolutely false. All this ideology, belief that this is so, is totally false. This is what I came to determine here. Is it true that they all say we're trapped? Absolutely false. They simply have a continuity fear. See, I got pulled into this world. Once you decide you get pulled, then all sorts of other stuff pulls you too. So it seems like you get pulled down by everything. But really what pulled me down was the belief that some souls, you know, some spirits were trapped. You know, I said, that's not fair. And they said, no, we can't. Look, we tried everything, nothing works. And, you know, so I said, wow. I said, Jesus, maybe you let them down or you didn't teach them right. I got to go down there and check this out. You know, is it really possible to be trapped? And so I went through the whole thing, trapped, as if I'm trapped and all that. One moment, please. As if I were trapped and put myself in that position of like, I'm completely trapped. There's no way I can get out. And then I said, okay, what's going to happen now? And the Holy Spirit showed up. I said, oh, okay. So when you bottom out, you turn to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's there. Nobody's trapped. That's a lie. And so I discovered the lie that being trapped just simply isn't true. It simply isn't true. We're here because of our spiritual pride. We try to be greater than God. It's futile. It's impossible. And now we just simply have a continuity fear, and we just need to evaporate that continuity fear through spiritual practice and discipline. And that's absolutely doable for everyone. No one is trapped. Not even one is trapped. None whatsoever are trapped. So by seeing through this lie, then all the other stuff that pulled me down, you know, it's easier to just dismiss this. This is nonsense. It's all based on a false premise. The Holy Spirit's with everyone. So people say, no, you got to stay here. You can't go to supernature. No, we need your help. No, the Holy Spirit's perfectly capable of helping everyone. Nobody is key here to salvation. Nobody is key. It's the Holy Spirit's the key to salvation. Nobody else. Because the Holy Spirit stays with us to the very end and will give the right practices to even the last one, you know, the last straggler who had the most arrogance and pride and the most severe continuity fear, no problem for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will give it exactly the right teachings, the right practices, so that one too, will evaporate the continuity fear. With just as much love and attention attention to detail and clarity, the Holy Spirit doesn't discriminate at all. So anyone who says there's discrimination here is not true. They're lying. That's self-deception. Because what they're saying is the Holy Spirit is discriminating. That's absolutely not true. Holy Spirit plays no favorites. Okay? Its attention is perfect. It doesn't need to play favorites. It has perfect attention on all. So there are no favorites. There's no real discrimination taking place whatsoever on the part of the Holy Spirit. And everything else is just, again, we claim this is happening to us so we can avoid paying attention to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit says, this tells you, it's practice. I am spirit. I am free. Discrimination cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Favoritism cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Unfairness cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Unfairness cannot happen to me. How can unfairness happen to the light? Consider that. The light itself, how can unfairness happen to the light? The living light. Not this electromagnetic, which is the light too. It's light in it. We asked it to appear to be frozen or crystallized. But the living light, how can anything happen? How can unfairness happen to the living light itself? How can unfairness happen to spirit? It's impossible. Totally impossible. Ridiculous. So nobody is trapped here. Nobody is being treated unfairly here. Nobody is just being discriminated against whatsoever. This is the part of the big lie, you know, which continuity fear is giving rise to. And they're saying, no, you have to stay here, you have to help me. There's no Holy Spirit, there's not, it's nonsense. I need a person, and no, you don't need a person here. The Holy Spirit is absolutely If there wasn't a single person on this in this world, and you're the only one here, and you're in this terrible condition, the Holy Spirit would be absolutely with you till the very end, and will gradually, gently help you evaporate the continuity fear. There's no question about it. The only thing standing in your way is laziness. That's it. And determination. And the more you suffer, the more determined you'll get to get free. And you'll say to laziness, hey, take a hike. I'm not interested in you, laziness, anymore. It's that simple. So nothing is standing. I am light. I am free. Barriers cannot happen to me. Okay? I am light. I am free. Barriers cannot happen to me. The light of all, how can there be barriers? There's no barriers. Barriers cannot happen to me. What was really going on is those who try to, you know, sour grape it and try to make this world their like a home for them. They know that those who are going to supernature seem very, very elevated and capable and stuff, and they desperately want them to stay in this world, and they want to kind of enslave them and sort of convince them to put all their effort and attention into beautifying this world and making this world a better place so they can feel more comfortable here, and they won't have to ever evaporate the continuity fear. This is what they can stay lazy, essentially. So they feel desperate. I gotta want to stay lazy. You know, I just need other people to do everything for me. I want to stay lazy. This is what's really going on. So that's why they're very angry. You know, you should not stay here and serving them, make their lives more comfortable, make things seem more comfortable here, so they don't even have to think about supernature. They say, nah, I don't need supernature. Forget it. I don't need it. Why? Things are getting better here all the time. All the time. Yeah, and they invent all sorts of affirmations and teachings for them to stay focused on. I am happy today. I am happy today. Things are getting better for me. As long as I think positive thoughts, the world's going to be a better place. You know, this power of positive thinking, they make up all this stuff, you know, that yeah, I can make this world a better place. Today I'm going to really get out there and, you know, spread this positivity to everybody, that we can make this world a better place. We can do it. We just got to, you know, right the wrongs of this world and all this kind of stuff. And it seems very compelling to them, because they're not even really looking at the totality of the situation at all. Understandably, it's very difficult for them to break out of these habits. But I am spirit, I am free. Habits cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Habits cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Compulsions cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. Compulsions cannot incomplete me. So those who claim to make charity and do all this stuff, just say, okay, fine. Well, listen, you do have a choice. What do you have on your plate? Do you want to have nature on your plate, or do you want to have supernature on your plate? That's the choice is still there. So let's talk about choice, can we not? Let's talk about choice. Instead of talking about charity, let's talk about choice first. So we're clear about what we're talking about here. I mean, I don't want to choose nature. Why are you choosing nature? See, let's look at that. And hey, I'm choosing supernature. So what's your attitude towards that? Let's talk about your attitude towards that. Why are you not choosing supernature? That's really the question. Why would anyone not want to choose supernature? See, so they have all this rationale about it. See, this is the problem, is they've rationalized, distorted the teaching, saying, no, this is what Jesus said. No, that Jesus said we have to work here to make this world a perfect place for us. No, none of that is true. This is all rationalizations. So there's a massive amount of rationalizations that they use. Just because they're too afraid, you know, they don't know how to evaporate their continuity fear is the problem. Why? Because they're trying to be greater than God, and so they can't bring themselves to ask God for help. See, the pride just won't let them ask God for help. They say, no, we have to do it, but we can't do it. Therefore, it's not doable. Okay, you follow this line of logic, illogic, because they want to keep God out. Okay? They want to keep God out because they were claiming, those who are maintaining the desire for nature, they're claiming they're greater than God. There's a way to be greater than God. So, obviously, you say, ask God for help. God's not going to help them be greater than God. Well, they've made up that this, actually, when they give themselves help, but don't want to admit it, and what they want to think is more powerful, they say, no, God told me that this is the help, and this is going to help and me co-created co-reality, you know. So, this should work, and they tell themselves that. But deep down, they realize God is not going to help us try to destroy reality. So they don't want to ask God, and by not asking God for help, that means that we try to do it for ourselves, and we can't do it ourselves. We don't know how to do it ourselves. We're lost and confused. And so then what we do to stay away from this feeling of, oh, I can't do it, I can't do it, I can't do it, there's something I really want to do but I can't do it, which is a terrible feeling, what we do is say, oh, that goal doesn't exist, that's nonsense, sour grapes, I don't want it anyway. Who would want that? Only idiots want that. Stupid. It's just some kind of myth. Fairy tale. Doesn't exist. Supernature. No such thing. And that seems to get calmed down because of the feeling like, I really want something but I can't get it, is a terrible feeling. Terrible feeling. Nobody is going to stick with that. You know? Horrible. But what's the remedy? Finally you say, God, I just feel like, you know what? I just can't continue on with nature. I don't care. I just can't continue on with it. I just can't stand it anymore. And it's just too much. The suffering's too terrible. And I realize it's futile. And so I got no choice but to... what I said was, hey, if there's any help anywhere to get free of this terrible confusion and suffering, I want to hear this advice, please. That's it. It was just an abstract request. And then help showed up. I didn't know what it was. It was abstract to me. It just helped showed up. And I began evaporating this continuity fear, just like that, right away. And it wasn't for quite some time. That maybe a couple years that I said, well, you know, it seems like we can call it the Holy Spirit, call it the grace of God. But there is some super intelligence within me, helping me. I was aware of that. Some super, super, super intelligence beyond anything that I could measure, quantify, or really even understand. Beyond anything I can understand, there was a super intelligence helping. But how it was helping, I couldn't understand. It just said, notice this. It's just my attention. It was like a play of attention. My play of attention changed. I began to, where before I put my attention here, now I had this feeling like, hey, how would it be if you put your attention over here? It was like that. That's what it was, a feeling like, I wonder how it would feel if I put my attention over here. It was just like that. And so I said, let me try it. I put my attention over here. And then the fear was just like, wow. I said, wow. If I had kept my attention over here, I would have completely missed this. And in fact, I've been missing this my whole life. I said, I never noticed that before. And that was like a big wow. So right away, wowism started. The path of wow started. The path of wow started. As soon as I asked for help, the path of wow started. I guarantee this will happen for everyone. But I just said, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to get out of this. I got no clue. I don't know. There's no way I can succeed. So I said, I need help. If there's any help available that actually knows how to get free of this trap I felt, trapped in chaos, then I will listen. I said, I will, please help me, because I will pay attention to your help. And then right away, some sort of super intelligence said, how would it be to put your attention here? Just little things, little things. Instead of looking here, you know, I look just like here. Something's trying to distract me. Instead of reacting to that distraction, I say, I'm going to just not react for a little while to this. Wow. And for me, it was just like constant wow. I said, oh my gosh, I never knew I could do this. I never knew this was possible. I never knew it was possible to put my attention like that, because I thought I'm supposed to, I have to do this. My attention has to be there. And now I just didn't do that, and wow. I turned my attention away from that. I did not have, wow. Something's happening, and I just try. Like on the freeway, there's a wreck on the freeway. Okay, it's off to the side of the freeway. I'm driving, and this feeling like, how would it be to just drive past with not even looking at this at all? I said, what? But it intrigues me. It intrigues me. It's like, this is very intriguing. I wonder what would happen. So it's your sense of adventure is engaged, and the Holy Spirit engages your sense of adventure because you have an inherent great adventurousness. God created spirit with this unlimited adventurousness. So the Holy Spirit engages our adventurousness. And so the Holy Spirit says, I get this feeling. The Holy Spirit's not talking to me with words. I just get this sort of feeling like, how would it feel like to just drive past this wreck and not pay any attention, just eyes on the road, and stay calm and relaxed? And so I said, I'm gonna try it. I'm gonna try this. And this is like, oh wow, never done this before. So first time for everything. It's like all these firsts start happening. First time I've done this, first. And there's thousands and thousands of firsts. So I say, how would it be to just drive past this wreck? Okay, just do it. It's like I'm totally into it, you know. I'm not gonna look. And I get through, and it's like, wow, that was so incredibly intense. Oh, it was amazing intensity for this. Because I thought, I have to look at this. If I don't look at it, something terrible is going to happen to me. There's something just like, I don't know, some mysterious, you know, I got to look. No. And what happens? Nothing happened to me. Nothing at all. It's like, that's it. That's easy. What? Nothing? No. Did God strike me dead? No. Did I feel like a terrible person? No. I mean, wow. I don't have to. I can, you know, I see the police, the fire, the first responders are there. So I say, that's cool. They got under control. I don't need to look at this. Stop. I don't need to slow down. Well, of course you slow down because of the, but I don't need to, you know, look at this. Go real slow. I can just okay. You know, it's all cordoned off and everything. Let's just keep going, you know. 25, 15, 20, just flow through. Don't have to gawk, don't have to be a rubbernecker. This is a perfect example. And I've done this many, 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 many times since then. Many, many times. Not every time. It's not trying to be pedantic about it. See, the Holy Spirit is not pedantic about its help, you know, and advice. But I know I can go past any accident and not look easily, you know, easily. So I'm not trying to be perfect that particular, you know, not be pedantic and let me be, you know, dogmatic or something. This dogmatism is not the goal here. Our goal is supernature, which is ultimately, you realize this whole world is nothing but a wreck by the side of the road. And you don't have to look at that wreck, right? It's a staged wreck, okay? We staged it for ourselves to distract our attention. So we think, oh, I gotta look at this. If I don't look at this, God will annihilate me, because if I go back home, God will get a hold of me, you know? If I return to God, God will get a hold of me and annihilate me. So God says, I can't let you try that again. Next time you might succeed. And, you know, we're afraid, we've told ourselves that God's out to get us, because we tried to separate from God and be greater than God. So God is like really scared and they just can't get a hold of us. You know, the reason why God's not annihilating us is because we think that we're somehow protecting ourselves and God can't get a hold of us. But if God gets a hold of us, you know, God's gonna get rid of us. We're dangerous to God, we think. So we think, well, gotta look at this world. This is what protects us. No. So ultimately, we just don't need to look at the world. I'm not gonna look at the world. It's there. Okay, the world's there. It's fine. Don't have to look at it. Don't have to pay attention to it. The wreck is there. I understand we're going slow. It's there. Fine. But my attention is looking at the beauty before me, you know. Beauty before me. Beautiful hills, beautiful mountains, beautiful sky, beautiful landscape, beautiful ambience. There's a terrible wreck over here. Okay, but I'm focused on the beautiful landscape, okay? Because I am spirit, I am free. Accidents cannot happen to me. I am light, I am free. Wrecks cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Accidents cannot incomplete me. I am light, I am free. Wrecks cannot incomplete me. So again, this world is nothing but a staged wreck, like at Universal Studios or something. It's all staged, actually. Everyone's pretending. This can happen to me. This can happen to me. None of this stuff can happen to me. None of this. I am spirit. I am free. There isn't anything that can happen to me. There isn't anything that can happen to me. So there's no happening there. We think, oh, there's something happening. I need to look. This is the happening. You know, I was told that there's some, that spirit was able to create some happening. And so this might be it. I need to look. No, it's not a happening. This world is not a happening. This universe is not a happening. Okay? We can never make universes happen to us. Okay? We can't make anything happen to us. Totally impossible. So, this world is not a happening. This world is not a happening. I remember in the 60s when, you know, Beatles, British Invasion, everything. And everyone was talking, you know, everyone was on drugs, basically. Especially the Brits after the war. They had, a lot of people got hooked on uppers, you know. It was very, very prevalent. Beatles were on uppers like crazy. A lot of Europe, young people in Europe were on uppers because the GIs used uppers to function, you know. I mean, the Germans used methamphetamine, actually. That's who invented methamphetamine. And the Allies produced all these upper speed, they call it speed. So all these young people were on speed. Let's be honest about the situation. So many were popping pills. They're popping, they didn't think anything. Yeah, pills, popping pills. They saw the GIs pop. GIs are just popping pills all the time. Nothing, coffee and pills in the morning. And this was speed they were popping. So they were all speeding. And here we are out in the peaceful, some leafy suburbs, you know, and all these speed freaks, you know, were coming on with their music and the radio, and then they were the television. Hey, we got the Beatles. How come the Beatles? Hey, Solomon. And a really big show here we have for you, the Beatles. We got speed. We're going to show you what speed does to you, folks. And we're watching this, and they said, this is happening. This is happening. This is what's happening. This is happening. And so we got this, the marketing of Madison Avenue and the Allies advertising machine, the marketing machine of the Allies, pumping out to everybody, of course, because the Cold War was now in their place. They basically want everybody to be hopped up on speed because they felt so threatened by the Soviets. And all these GIs are coming back after the war, actually. Well, after the war, this culture of you know, the Cold War happened, and they wanted everybody to be caffeinated on speed, up, so we could build our economy back up. So it's so powerful that we could defeat the Soviets. Basically, the Allies wanted, you know, to feel like they had the will and the power to win the Cold War. And so this was part of the marketing. Everybody was supposed to be all pepped up, all hyped up. And say that there's a happening going on. This is happening. This is what's happening to us, you know. So you felt like all the world started happening. I felt like the world started to happen to me. You know, before I didn't feel that way. I always blame the Beatles for it, you know. But I have to say, well, I am spirit, I am free. The Beatles cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. The Beatles cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. The Beatles cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. The British invasion cannot happen to me. I am light, I am free. The Beatles cannot happen to me. I am light, I am free. The Beatles cannot incomplete me. Okay? I am spirit, I am free. The British invasion cannot incomplete me. I am spirit, I am free. The happening cannot incomplete me. I am light, I am free. Madison Avenue cannot incomplete me. So what happened was, the youth of America, we were just, you know, feeling like it's very spiritual. I felt very spiritual and young, and I didn't feel like anything was happening to me. I felt like, you know, nothing can happen to me, actually. This is how I felt. Nothing can happen to me. This world cannot happen to me. And this British invasion came in with all the pop culture that it brought with it, which was, at that time, the Cold War was getting really, really, really serious. A very dangerous situation. Cuban Missile Crisis, I think, was it. I don't know about when, what year was that, but early 60s. I mean, the world was on the brink of a nuclear holocaust, actually. And so we were told all this stuff can happen to us, all this happened. We keep telling this is going to happen, this is what can happen to you, this is what can happen to you. No, I am spirit, I am free. Atomic destruction cannot happen to me. I am light, I am free. Atomic destruction cannot happen to me. Cannot happen to me. Okay. So we get all these speed freaks saying this is happening, this is happening, this is happening. And so you got this culture that started getting all pepped up, you know, all hyped up. Everyone was hyper. And then everyone started, all this stuff's happening. They said, no, embrace the happening. This is the happening. Yeah. This is the happening. It's happening to you. Let the happening happen to you. This is what the culture was. So I am light. I am free. Culture cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Culture cannot happen to me. What happened was you get Elvis, and then you get the Beatles, and in the Cold War, and what really happened was, you know, the girls went bonkers for them, absolutely bonkers. We were in school, just, you know, and then all these girls are like we didn't exist anymore. You know, they're sort of just a normal socialization was there, and it was no problem. We got along. And then suddenly the boys didn't exist anymore. It was only the Beatles, you know, the Beatles. And the girls just came flipped out entirely over all this, just flipped out. It's just like, wow. They started getting all hyper, and they became completely weird to us. All the boys are just saying, wow, girls are certainly became super weird. What's going on? It was this cosmic corporate culture as it was working through the drug culture, the Beatles, the happening, the British invasion, the speed freakness, and all of this, you know. Let's make this world a perfect place. We got to defeat the Soviets, you know. We have this terrible situation. We have to feel just, they thought we could win it with showing how great capitalism, American capitalism is, you know, Western capitalism. So we felt obligated to prove to the Soviets that Western capitalism produced this incredibly happy, well-adjusted, rich, you know, affluent, beautiful people. And that if we just let capitalism happen to us, you know, we could then win the Cold War, by the Soviet people would see how great we are, and they'd say, oh, I want that too, you know, and they'd get rid of the Bolsheviks and, you know, socialism, all that kind of stuff. So thunderstorm just started. I am a spirit, I am free. Rain cannot happen to me. Nature cannot happen. Weather cannot happen to me. That was bizarre. I am light, I am free. Bizarreness cannot happen to me, actually. There's a bona fide thunderstorm. We know it's never happened here. I mean, it was just calm, and suddenly it just started downpouring. Now suddenly it's very windy, stormy. I am spirit, I am free. Storms cannot happen to me. Whoa. Hey, it's blowing in mist. That's incredible. That was really fun. Very fun. Rarely do we see anything like that here. I am spirit, I am free. Rareness cannot happen to me. Rarity cannot happen to me. Cold, my gosh, it suddenly got very cold, just like in an instant. Wow, I have not experienced something like that, really. This is very interesting. We're talking about what's going on here. The Cold War, you know. Speaking of that, the return of the Cold War, as I have been telling people, just from my spiritual intuition, there is the Cold War is raging right now against Russia. is an intentional effort to collapse their economy. Oil's down to $55 a barrel. This doesn't just happen like it happened. It's been orchestrated for sure. For sure. And Russia's on the brink of a recession. You know? So, gosh, this coal mine, this is just... Wow. Cold War, you know, is happening again. So, we were told it's up to you, the American boys and girls, to win the war, Cold War, by just showing what happy, adjusted, how we love the authority of capitalism, how we love living under, how we love having nature happen to us, how we love to have all this, you know, materialism happen to us. And if you didn't go along, you know, maybe you're a communist, maybe you sided with the Ruskies, you know, they told you, like, guys, like, what the hell are you guys talking about? You know, I mean, this is nonsense. Nothing can happen. There isn't anything that can happen to me. Atomic bombs cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Atomic bombs can't happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Totalitarianism can't happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Capitalism cannot happen to me. There isn't anything that can happen to me. I am light. I am free. Coldness cannot happen to me. Although, I may, because of the continuity fear, I am feeling some cold. I may have to get a jacket. This is amazing. Well, I am spirit, I am free. Amazement cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Amazement cannot happen to me, obviously. Yeah, I'm gonna get a jacket. 1 minute here. This is like, okay, wow. This is pretty interesting. I am spirit. I am free. Crucifixion cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Crucifixion cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Crucifixion cannot incomplete me. This feels like a crucifixion story. Stop in the wild. So intense. And it's Christmas somewhere right now, right? And maybe this is the symbolizing the crucifixion of Christ. As nature, of course, is the believed crucifixion of Christ. Nature is our belief we can crucify what we are. See, we can crucify spirit. This is nature. This is our belief to possibly crucify God. I am spirit, I am free. Crucifixion cannot happen to me. See, I am light, I am free. Crucifixion cannot happen to me. But I have never experienced something quite like this in California, really. That was no warning at all. It was not even a little drop starting to come down. It just instantly started pouring. I said, what? I didn't even know what it was. And the weather must have dropped by 15 degrees within a matter of a minute. Ah, I'm shivering. Wow. You talk about a disturbance. Well, I am spirit. I am free. Disturbance cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Disturbance cannot happen. Now, in supernature, this cannot happen. This does not and cannot happen. Okay, absolutely not. Only in this realm of nature can something like this happen. And I'm glad I was not out somewhere, like playing golf or some walking or doing anything, because this was like a very savage shift. I said, I am spirit, I am free. Shifts cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Savagery cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Storms cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Storms cannot happen to me. So remember, we're preparing for supernature. And we're affirming how supernature is. What is supernature like? Well, I am spirit, I am free. Storms cannot happen to me. Shifts cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Deluges cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Cannot happen to me. See, then my whole body shaking and trembling. That's how severe the shift was then. Wow. I can tell you a story. It's a true story. My uncle, who's a very healthy person, very clear-minded, healthy person, took a walk up in the hills of a desert. He's where he lived, and he took a walk every day, the same basic walk. And he was up there in the ridge, you know, quite a ways from his home, and walking, in very great shape. He was elderly, you know, in his 80s, and this is just something just like this happened. A sudden thunderstorm happened, unexpected. It was just a cloudy day, but for some reason, an intense thunderstorm happened. And he was just, you know, he didn't have a coat on. He was just hiking in the desert. It wasn't cold before then. And it was a DHL guy. He got stuck in this storm too. He's like, wow. He says, this is so unexpected. This doesn't happen. This is really weird, that is for sure. Anyway, my uncle, thunderstorm like this, just like this happened. And like a flash frozen actually. And he got all totally drenched. And then this super coldness hit him. And this caused rapid evaporation of his core body temperature. And he went into severe hypothermia. Uncontrolled trembling, which I feel actually almost uncontrolled trembling right now, and he made it back to his house, but he couldn't speak, because your whole body's trembling, you can't speak, and he couldn't prepare any food for himself, just shaking like this. I've had hypothermia before, and I know exactly what it's like. He couldn't prepare food, so he would just lay there, trying to get himself warm. He couldn't eat, eventually a friend came by, I think, and knock, knock, and then over there, and came in, and he's like, you know, lying there in bed, just shaking and can't talk, you know, and so they said, oh my gosh, something horrible's happened. They called the 911. They rushed him to the hospital, because something, you know, some sort of medical emergency here, and they brought in this young doctor, to diagnose him. And the doctor diagnosed him with Alzheimer's disease. He's just suffering from Alzheimer's. He's not able to talk. He's having an acute experience of Alzheimer's. And he just pulled this, you know, I mean, just stereotyped him and says, oh, this is an old person, can't talk. He's not communicating, not giving good answers. Like, he couldn't talk because of his central nervous system. Lost his core temperature so bad. And I'm having trouble talking right now. Wow. And they started giving him this drug for Alzheimer's, Aricept, and that totally messed him up, because he didn't have a trace of Alzheimer's. As a matter of fact, I had just visited with him a while ago. He was as clear as a bell, absolutely clear as a bell. So they started giving him this Aricept, very strong medicine, and that really caused some psychotic episodes and problems with him. And then they said, look, you see, wow, he's really bad off. Then they put him in a lockdown facility. So he went within a matter of days from this wonderful, lucid person, you know, being this wonderful, the most humorous person I've ever met. That's how intelligent he was. He had such great intelligence, he could be incredibly humorous. He went from that, taking a nice hike out in nature, to a lockdown facility on heavy anti-dementia medication in a lockdown facility. Nobody even knew where he was. Nobody even knew where he was. So I eventually somehow he was able to give a phone number. For me, and I got a call and says, hey, do you know this person? We have him here in the lockdown facility. He's suffering from severe Alzheimer's. But they said, we don't think he has dementia. We're kind of wondering, did he have dementia before? He said, no. They said, well, you know, we better look into this. Okay. So help arrived. Holy Spirit helped out. Okay, so spiritual practice will tell us none of this can happen to us. Okay. I am light. I am free. Dementia cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Hypothermia cannot happen to me. Now, we know that there are yogis who like to, for practice, spiritual practice, they will focus in on something like hypothermia, and that they will keep their mind knowing hypothermia cannot happen to me up in the Himalayas or something. And they will wrap themselves, they'll put these sheets, robes in water, icy cold water, and then wrap themselves in these sheets up there on the, you know, and sit on a stone up there, high altitude where it's absolutely freezing, the piercing winds are there, and just sit there in meditation. And they don't lose any core body temperature at all. In fact, the robe heats up, you know, nothing happens to them because they realize I am spirit, I am free. Hypothermia cannot happen to me. I am not a body, I am free, I am spirit, still spirit as God created me. I am spirit, I am free. Cold cannot happen to me. Nothing can happen. There's not anything that can happen to me. But they're specializing in that. You don't need to do that. You don't need to. But it's just a training technique. So, unfortunately, my uncle was a nature lover. And so he put his faith in nature. He put his faith in nature. Now, if he would have known this spiritual practice, if he would have tuned to the Holy Spirit and asked the Holy Spirit for help, things may have turned out differently. Ultimately, I got in touch and helped him out. He got out of there. But it damaged the aircept. Caused problems and started a decline in him, actually. So nature eventually pulled him down, too. We didn't think anything could pull him down. Nature played a very vicious trick on him, did it not? I don't know any situation I've ever heard such a vicious trick like that. One day, you're just, you know, perking along in your old age, and everyone loves you, and you're just a wonderful person, and 2 days later, you're in a lockdown facility on heavy anti-dementia medication, and you never really recover from it. Actually, you never really recovered from it. You talk about tragic. You know, best person I've ever met in my life. And look how nature pulled him down like that. A belief in nature pulled him down. So if you just say, hey, I am spirit, I am free, nature cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Nature cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Sickness cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Pharmaceuticals cannot happen to me. Pharmaceuticals cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Troubles cannot happen to me. I am light. I am free. Misfortune cannot happen to me. The only problem I have is a continuity problem. I don't have any problem except the continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. Yes, it's a very severe problem, but that's the only problem that I have. I am spirit. I am absolutely free. There isn't anything that can happen to me. So if you start practicing this, practicing and practicing, it's going to have its sway. In one way or the other. Now this front is moving through, and the sunlight, actually we've seen some light coming through, and it's like it seems to have passed by, but I am spirit, I am free. The bodies cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Flesh cannot happen to me. Flesh cannot happen to me. Spirit, I am. free. Misfortune cannot happen to me. I am spirit. I am free. Misfortune cannot happen to me. So I can tell you that this extreme misfortune that happened to my uncle shook me up so bad. I got real serious about the spiritual path. I was already super serious, but this brought even greater intensity and seriousness to it. And I was realizing, whoa, something, you know, nature worship, all this. I said, wait a minute, what's going on here? Trusting in nature, you know, trusting in that nature can't happen to me, but I can just make it happen in the right way to me. See, this is the trouble we get into. Because we say, yeah, sure, all the sickness, all the stuff can happen to me, but it's not going to happen to me. Because I'm going to protect myself from it. This is the big mistake that we make. And this is the mistake Jesus points out to us. Thank God for Jesus to point out this mistake. Because it's a very, very clever mistake that we fall into. So instead of saying, I am spirit, I am free, sickness cannot happen to me. We say, I am spirit, but sickness can happen to me. However, I'm going to pray to God and keep it from happening to me. This is our big, big, big mistake. We all make it, okay? Don't get down on yourself for making this mistake. This mistake I made, mistake everybody makes, for sure. Until we start seeing through, and it's not easy to see through this, we think, well, how could there be anything else? Of course this stuff happens to us. No, nothing. There isn't anything that can happen to me. All this is a mirage, a dream, a symbolic dream representing, you know, what if something could happen to me? What if something could happen? But nothing can, there isn't anything that can happen to me. I am light. I am the living light. I am the living light. I am absolutely free. There is nothing, there isn't anything that can happen to me. There isn't anything at all that can happen to me. And claiming that our intrinsic nature is something that is happening to us is, of course, level confusion. Freedom isn't happening to us. We are freedom. We are the freedom. It's not happening to us. You can use these practices and use positive things and say, I am spirit, I am free. Freedom can't happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Peace can't happen to me. Well, it's true. I am peace. How can it be happening to me? It's not possible. There isn't something outside of me that is happening to me. So some external freedom cannot happen to me. External peace cannot happen to me. External bliss cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Bliss can't happen to me. That's also a very valid practice that many people find very difficult. But if you can practice that way, absolutely practice that way. That's even more advanced practice, actually. But I don't want to confuse this you too much, because many will say, well, wait a minute, we want freedom. What do you mean freedom can't happen? But, you know, if you can catch the subtlety here, that there isn't anything at all that can happen to me. I am what I am. I am. I am. I am this. Isness is. Isness, it doesn't have isness happening to it. As I say, reality doesn't need reality. Meaning, reality doesn't need reality to happen to reality. There's no reality happening to reality. Oh, wow. The blue sky, sun. My gosh. My gosh. I am spirit, I am free. Intensity cannot happen to me. I am spirit, I am free. Spirit cannot happen to me. Spirit doesn't need spirit to happen to spirit. Truth doesn't need truth to happen to truth. So the mistake we make, that we are undoing this mistake now, okay? The mistake that makes us feel trapped in nature is to say, sure, all nature, all the universe is happening to me. Of course it's happening. What are you talking about? Of course it's happening. But I can find out a way to keep it from, prevent it from happening, at least do a pretty good job of it, you know, more or less. You see, I can more or less try to keep it from happening to me. So then we make up false religions, false teachings, and says, God, 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 God. I'm in this terrible place and all this stuff is happening to me. Will you please, please show me how I can keep it from happening to me? This is false teaching. This is dualistic false teaching. False prayers, false teaching. It doesn't work. It doesn't work for us. For to say that anything could happen to us is saying that this can happen to God. And because we're the author of the supposed happening, we're saying we created something that can happen to God. So we must be greater than God, because even God cannot do that. So if we're saying it can happen to us, we're saying essentially, when we say anything can happen to us, we're saying we're greater than God. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. No way around it. So by saying there isn't anything that can happen to me, we're saying there isn't anything that can happen to God. Which means, hey, that must mean the reality is all totally perfect and glorious as it's always been. And I want to get back. I want to get you know, get experiencing that. I want to get experiencing that instead of this trying to experience this insanity, this lunacy of happenings. There are no happenings. But we are brought up on happenings. Hey, there's this happening here going on, this big happening, really big happening now. You thought that stuff couldn't happen. Well, you're wrong. Here comes this really big happening. And if you don't think so, those Soviets, you know, they can drop, you know, bombs on every city, and you that'll be a happening. I'll tell you that. You know, and how dare you don't think there's happenings? You know, and it's like, so it kind of, you know, crushed my spirit. I felt, of course, I am spirit. I am free. Crushing cannot happen to me. Okay, crushing cannot incomplete me. But the collective freak out here was so strong that, you know, it kind of, I lost my voice, you know, I lost my capacity to get this out to the world. But it was just unbelievably intense. You cannot even imagine how intense it was then. With every day we're living like, hey, wait, are the Soviets going to just carpet bomb the U.S. with nuclear weapons, and we respond and carpet bomb them, and basically it's the end of the world. Nuclear winter. That's it. Finished. Complete world, totally radioactive. So, I am spirit, I am free. Radioactivity cannot happen to me. See, I am spirit. I am absolutely, perfectly free. Radioactivity cannot happen to me. So, when we do these practices, I put all these different words in here to trigger all these happenings we think happened to us, not just this life, but in all previous lives, the whole sojourn, the whole detour into fear, as Jesus calls it, to let go of all this, realizing nothing's ever happened to me, nothing has ever, and as some teachers say, nothing has ever happened. This, nothing has ever happened anywhere to anything, anyone. Nothing has ever happened to anyone. Nothing has ever happened to spirit. That thunderstorm was just like kaboom. So, we are in another Cold War. And again, we are now being sucked into, I feel these things are being orchestrated to just be used to suck the world into materialism, into saying, globally, look how great our economy is, look how great everything's going, look how happy we are, look how beautiful we are, you know. Yeah. So this needs to happen to everyone, you see. This needs to be, this is so great, it needs to happen to everyone. So how dare you say stuff cannot happen to us. No, we need it to happen. That's how we get peace, they say. So what they believe is, we just need to have the right happening to everyone in order to have peace. But Jesus' teaching is quite different from this, saying there isn't anything that can happen to me. Even peace can't happen to me. Okay, I am peace. Peace cannot happen to me. I am peace. I am peace. I am free. Peace cannot happen to me. Okay, I am peace, I am free, peace cannot happen to me. Okay, if you really want to, and we do, if you really want to put a stop to the insanity here,